When I was young, I wanted to be an astronaut. But by the third grade, young Four Eyes Harri was not going to be a test pilot. So looking to the sky, I waved goodbye to that dream. That goal never left my heart, although I became a lawyer. In a different but very real sense, I embraced the challenge of exploring the galaxies of law and how law worked to provide a civilizing force in Western civilization. The frontiers found were the weight of authority rather than weightlessness.
Moving ahead to November 13th, 2002, where were you? I was fortunate to be at the Kennedy Space Center in Cape Canaveral, Florida, where I was able to relive a childhood dream. This is America's spaceport, an operating facility with a museum, art gallery, guided tours, displays of actual rockets, half a century of spectacular space history. This place pays tribute to pioneers in conquering space. Paul Goddard, it is difficult to say what is impossible, for the dream of yesterday is the hope of today and reality of tomorrow. Wernher von Braun, what is the most important thing a man or woman needs if they want to build? The will to do it.
One of the wonders of this place is the opportunity to visit with real live astronauts, because at least one is there daily to meet the public and answer questions. On November 13th, 2002, the NASA astronaut on duty was Bill Pogue. He is a humble, soft-spoken man with graying hair, and he wears glasses. I immediately liked him.
He was an inspiration. He graduated from college and earned his master's degree in math from a small church-related college in Oklahoma that I had never heard of. He joined the Air Force, and after trying more than once, he joined the ranks of America's space pilots.
He flew three missions to the International Space Lab. Those were high points in his past life. But now he talks about his mission in his present life after his space missions, explaining the exploration of space to another generation so that it would have the will and commitment to carry on with scientific research.
After his formal presentation, I encountered him in the center's art gallery. Together, we looked at some of the collected works celebrating and documenting space exploration. And we talked at greater length, and so I asked him, what kind of person did NASA want for an astronaut? His answer? NASA looks for individuals with a wide range of interests because they are better able to work with others as a team. Teamwork, what a concept. Take some NASA astronauts, for example. Dorothy Metcalf Lindenberger. Team sports, challenging her students with her geology classes. She's in the teacher and space program. June 2005, I visited with Alan Bean, a man who landed on the moon three times. Is an accomplished painter and still takes lessons to learn and improve his painting techniques. He also spends his time helping younger artists develop their careers.
Now, the Kennedy Center has two IMAX theaters. That evening, Pat and I were among a small group who attended the world premiere of the IMAX version of Apollo 13. What an experience. To watch the movie in the large format truly allows, or perhaps forces, you to become a part of history. You know the story of Apollo 13, an uneventful space launch, and then a massive systems failure from an explosion that almost meant the loss of the mission, the spacecraft, and the three astronauts. Yet through ingenuity and tenacity, the NASA team solved the problems, and the mission became a successful failure from an almost certain catastrophe. The movie adventure is high drama. I watched the movie twice, straight through, when a friend gave it to me, until 3 a.m.
After the movie, we had dinner two tables away from Gene Kranz, the director of the Flight Center, and Jim Lovell, who was an astronaut in Apollo 13. We sat at a table with people from Florida, California, the Midwest, Spain, and Australia. After dinner, both Gene Kranz and Jim Lovell spoke. Some friends gave Kranz a tailored vest from his wife, just like the ones she always made for him for the different missions. As they spoke, I realized the true stature of these individuals, literal giants of the 20th century. I was so moved by the experience, I pulled out a 3x5 card and took notes. Some of the points that Jean Kranz made, quote, "We made lots of mistakes, but we corrected them and we moved on." If you have a no surrender attitude, then you'll solve the problem. Teamwork is the work of a lot of people in whom you have a lot of confidence. His team consisted of a bunch of recent college graduates. No one had more than 5 years of experience with NASA. And yet he had that total confidence in them, and they solved the problem. Quote, "Failure is not an option," end quote. Enough said. Jim Lovell, an astronaut and the mission commander, the author of Lost Moon, the chairman of the Astronaut Scholarship Program, explains how the book came about.
After the experience, the three astronauts were flown by helicopter safely to the carrier, and they all agreed that they should write a book. That didn't happen. Predictably, procrastination proceeded to prevent publication. But a publisher approached Lovell about the time of his retirement and agreed to write a book when he got the time. A few weeks later, the publisher called and they said he had sold his book that he had not yet started to Hollywood. That got him going. Something about deadlines, dollars, and promises in the deals. Basically, the movie is very accurate. Lovell. He saw Apollo 13 as a test of attributes, a triumph over problems, an example of good leadership, imagination, relearning, teamwork, perseverance, and motivation. A successful failure from an absolutely certain catastrophe. And the greatest Apollo 13 accomplishment of them all? What we did on the flight has been such an inspiration to others. Were those involved scared? Did they think they wouldn't make it? Lovell said, "I got worried when more than three systems failed. A test pilot can fly with two systems out, but when three or more go out, well..." Kranz, "I never considered failure. 20 minutes in, and I realized how serious the problem was, but I had total confidence in my team to solve the problems." And they did.
If we think about the law and problem as problem solving, we can learn from the Apollo 13 mission experience. There are lessons in life and law from Apollo 13. First, in Apollo 13, in that mission, they never considered defeat. Failure for them was not an option. They worked on solving the problem, not assigning blame. And they prepared to the third power. They wouldn't have been able to figure out what to do within the natural laws without a basic database of natural laws which they had mastered to perfection. For example, they knew their math. They knew the laws of physics. They knew about human physiology. They were masters of their domain. This knowledge and mastery of natural laws, of physical laws, helped them develop options for problem solving. They prepared a series of emergency drills and had a fallback procedures in place, which resulted in a successful plan to survive. Redundancy and systems were crucial.
Practical discipline became habitual and allowed protocol to prevail over the stress of emotions. It permitted improvisation and the creation of a plan to succeed. Teamwork saved the day. Total confidence in each member of the team allowed each to contribute and all to succeed. Ken Mattingly, who couldn't fly because the doctors believed he might have the measles, had the ability to ask the key questions in any group or setting so that all the answers fell into place. Keeping an eye on the goal permitted reaching it. Balanced individuals with wide ranges of interests work best in teams and are better at problem solving. Use a never surrender attitude. Failure is not an option. Attributes of success: leadership, learning and relearning, perseverance, imagination, courage, motivation, and innovation. new frontiers lie ahead to challenge succeeding generations and give them the opportunity for greatness as well.
A space shuttle involves the synchronization of over 2 million separate systems to take astronauts to space and return them safely to Earth. When I heard that on an earlier trip to Cape Canaveral, I was puzzled, uneasy, and restless, perhaps disappointed with my life. IRAC didn't seem like rocket science.
Yet, on further reflection, the practice of law was more than rocket science. Because while travel in space and the space shuttle dealt with mastery and managing predictable laws of nature, physics, chemistry, math, physiology, the practice of law deals, as it always will in a free society, with the eternal unpredictability of the human mind, spirit, and experience, and with the particular needs of others. That's the continuing new frontier, the opportunity to serve, to solve problems, to lead, to assist in people's individual search for meaning in their lives in a free society.
Well, all good things come to an end. You will soon be the Harri alumni. Some of the advantages are the status and esprit de corps, the opportunity to continue the friendships we have made beyond this small section, beyond the first year, law school, and practice. At the same time, as Harri alum, you will feel a special sense of responsibility and feel that you need to act on them in your personal and professional life. Tom Hanks, it has been a pleasure flying with you. Professor Harri, a pleasure to learn with you. I have great confidence in your future and great expectations for them. I thank you for the privilege of being part of your first year of law.